Okay, we want to talk about the word as the point of direction, or the beginning, the beginning point of direction, because that is the beginning. And if it is the beginning, we're looking for direction for our life, for our situations. Then the word should be the starting point. Doesn't that make sense? You know? Well, I'm probably going to say step out of my notes, but there's a lot of people that go to get a word from the Lord. Or show me a sign or whatever. And God's good. He'll do stuff like that. But that's not his preferred choice. He would rather speak to you through his word, because that is eternal. So let me just read a little bit. When you go back to the beginning, there's nothing but the word, because in the beginning was the word. Where the word was God. Nothing else there. From the beginning, only in the Word can we find direction. From the beginning, only in the Word can you truly find eternal direction. So how many places do you go for direction in a time of crisis? Usually go to another person during crisis. And one reason usually is because we're closer to another person than we are to the Word. You really, really have found that God's Word is your primary source of direction. Now, does this mean that friends who get good counsel aren't of God or can't be trusted? No, you can do that. God says you can confirm the Word, but they're not going to agree with you. Authorities, God gives you people in authority, you can go to them. But even they should give you the Word. Right? You know, and you should really count it a blessing to have somebody who quotes the word to you when you don't want to hear it.
Amen. Words are dealing with me about that kind of thing. I was just noticing that scripture you quoted was confirm the word in the mouth of two more witnesses. Uh-huh. In order to confirm the word, you had to have heard the word.
Right.
And a lot of times, the Lord's been showing me that in the past, and even still currently, I have a tendency to think of, oh, I have this problem. I need to go to my dean or my pastor or my friend and get an answer. And he's been telling me that, no, you need to hear me and hear me first. Now, it may come through a person first.
Right.
But you've got to hear his word first. And then it may be, then you can confirm it through other people. And I've never noticed that in the order of that scripture, you have your own thoughts about what the word is,
right,
where it comes from. And the word is strictly from the heart of God and not from anybody else. It can be confirmed through others. Which is the right word. Confirm the word.
That's right.
But you have to hear it to confirm it.
A good example of that is, say, somebody like a pastor or somebody who knows the Lord does quote you the word, and you go to them and you need direction or you need counsel, and they give you the word. You go act on that. First of all, when you hear the word, there's a bearing witness in your spirit, isn't it? You go, wow, I know this is right. Then when you go act on it and it works out, you go, wow, that's really good. Now here's where the breakdown can come. You can begin to always go to that person because you know you're going to get the word from them. But in your mind, you're not thinking, I'm always going to that person because I know I'm going to get the word. You're thinking, I'm always going to that person because their counsel is always right and they're good and they love me and they're going to keep me straight. You catch all that? When in reality, all they're doing is they've got a foundation on the word.
That's right.
And they're passing it along, and they're not trying to become something. They're trying to do what you should be doing. Get the word and live it and pass it on.
It's kind of like the real deception is they aren't even really getting the word.
Right. Right.
They are.
Right.
Because it's not live in them. It's not rhema to them.
Right.
And so the real deception is they aren't even really getting the word.
Right.
They're getting, for you who speak it, and it's like to you, the counselor, it's the word, but for them to receive that very same word, unless it's God breathed to them and they make it their own from God, they're not even getting the word.
Right.
So they aren't even really following God.
No. And you know, they may know you're of God, so they're following God as much as they can by following you, but still, you know, what the Lord desires is, in the beginning, with you, with me, with everybody, the Word, because the Word is God. Yeah. But then that be eventually your starting point, your always starting point. Then you can go to a leader, you can go to a friend or whatever, and they will at least confirm the Word. But they're just confirming the word that you already have received. Jared?
Yeah, a couple places in Corinthians and even the Old Testament, that's what the children of Israel did with Moses. It speaks of, one is his face was glowing and shining, and he had to put on a veil over his face, and what they, basically what they were saying in the Old Testament is that they told him, we don't want to hear God's voice anymore, you tell us what God is saying to us. And so what you're really not following the Lord. You're just what you are, you're just a servant being told what to do, and that's all you're, if that's how you react to people, if you're going to somebody else to, for them to get counsel from them or to get the word from them, you're really not getting any word. You're just being a servant being told what to do.
Well, another thing, another deception that I've seen that goes along with that is that, I'm not going to clarify this because people get off, but, you know, we go, okay, well, you know, my friends or my pastor or my whatever, they have the word, and I have this confidence that I'm not going to get off because they're going to correct me with the word. Okay, and that's true. That's good if that's there. But you know there will come a time in your walk and in your relationship with the Lord where he will, like, in some way or another, shut that down because he wants you to, you see, if I'm not responsible, that my boundaries are way out there. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, they are way out there, and you can jump in or not jump in. Or, hey, I want direction. You know what I mean? I don't really want it. You know, but when you realize, man, this is between me and God, and my first responsibility is with the Lord, then you go, you're not, hopefully you're not as open to deception and flagrantly walking off and this and that, but rather you begin to go, man, this is important that I have a relationship with the Lord in the Word. Right? Now?
Yeah, that's really cool. That, you know, getting off by thinking that you can hear from somebody and not get off is that's really a fallacy because it implies that you were on.
Right. Yeah.
And the fact of the matter is, following the Lord is a state of being and it's a life. It's not what you do or not making mistakes or not sinning or being good. It's a life, it is a state of being, and until it's that state of being and that life operating through you, you aren't even on. And so in reality, the whole thing's a fallacy, that even this friend can stop you from getting off. I understand what you're saying. I'm not playing with words because you can, quote unquote, get off.
Right.
And end up going into some Satan worshiper thing, you know, and you know, I'm not saying that you can't, like, get off, okay, on that level. I'm talking on the ultimate sort of level, okay? On ultimate this level, you know, you're not really on. What that person is doing by stopping you from getting off is, for that period of time, it's Moses taking you to the promised land to get you established in the land, which is Christ, to get you on.
And before you go on, we need to say right here, but maybe that's necessary for Moses to do that for a period of time. So you need leaders, you need friends, you need this or that. But that is, you know, till we all come. That's where we're going.
Oh, yeah. Well, you said once in a sermon, you know, it's like, well, if it's a two-year-old or something, it's a money, whatever, you know, that's maturity. But, you know, if you're like 22 and you're doing that, then it's not maturity. And so maturity isn't, once again, what you're doing or so forth, as far as where the Lord has you and so forth, and like, yeah, and Moses was a crucial part of the Word. He's in the Word. That's a part of growth and development. And without that, you know, you're going to probably get off. But the mistake is when you don't truly understand what on and off is.
That's right.
See, they were never deceived into thinking, when they were in the wilderness, they never thought they were in the land.
Right.
See, the true deception would have been if one day they woke up and somebody said, hey, what if we're already in the land? Yeah, okay, we're already in the land, yay! They were never deceived. They knew they were on the way to the land. Therefore, their relationship with Moses was in a proper order.
Right.
Where if one day they thought they were in the land and following Moses, now they're deceived.
picture. This is going to be kind of rough, this is reality. I've known people, churches, here's the beginning. It begins with the word, okay? But a church, the pastor, the church, the direction, the ministry, it all ends up way down here, raised up of the Lord, because the Lord wants an emphasis on eldership or praise and worship. Let's say praise and worship, okay? So they're raised up right here, and the pastor's all, you know, praise and worship and da-da-da and all this kind of stuff. And so that is the dealing of the Holy Spirit on that man and that church at that time. Okay? You got everybody following me? And they're right here. And so they're on track. We're talking about being off. Okay? They're on track with the Holy Spirit's movement in relationship to praise and worship. Okay? And so they're on track and they're going. And let's say a person gets off over here and they start saying, well, you know, I don't like raising my hands. Okay? So I don't like worship. Okay? But that's God's call for this body. So you could say they are off. You understand what I'm saying? You could say they're off. Okay? But we're going to see here in a second that they never were fully on in the way out what I was saying. But on the subject matter of praise and worship, they are off. And the pastor may go to them, open the scripture, show a bunch of stuff, and go, you know, lifting holy hands, and they may go, my God, that's the New Testament. Which in reality just occurred to me. You know, so even that is, and of course it all is established on the word. But he gets back on, really not with the word, because the church isn't on with the word. He gets back on with the move of the Spirit for that church, and now everybody's moving variably along the path. Okay. Guess what? Even if it's the Holy Spirit, even if it's the direction, even if it's on for that period of time, what happens is that church will go so long, and that pastor is not really founded on the Word. And that church has never been founded on the Word. They're founded on praise and worship. And the Word was before our created beginning. And will be after. When Jesus comes back, written on his vestures, the Word of God. The Word of God was before there was anything, and it's going to be long after it's over with. Okay? But all this other stuff isn't. So it's a temporary dealing. You know what happens? That pastor may get off, or those people get off, not from the subject that they're on, but they don't have any foundation. And so one or two things can happen. I mean, either something can go wrong, or they all disseminate, or maybe they just kind of, and I see this more than anything else, they just kind of slowly break apart, and they're just not there. Anybody ever seen that with the church? I've seen that many times with the church. Okay, so what is the problem? Because now they're not even in existence, okay? Did they get off? Well, not from this. Maybe they were true to that. But God's not emphasizing praise and worship anymore. Maybe down here he's wanting to emphasize something else. Okay. They should have started back here in the beginning, got everything, not just praise and worship, but everything based on the Word. And then they were based on the Word. So when he shared scriptures about praise and worship, he'd say, but the Word is the final authority. And the Word, he'd emphasize and give preeminence to the Word. And then they would say, man, we give preeminence to the Word. And one of the things in the Word is praise and worship. And bless God. See what I'm saying? Okay. But they didn't have the Word, so they couldn't continue forever. Because the foundation, the eternal foundation before creation, verse 3, we haven't got to yet, had not been laid. So it was a temporal dealing, it was a temporal church, it was a temporal thing. Haven't you ever wondered, you know, and this is not to compare by reason of good or bad, but how churches with more money, bigger things happen, have come and gone since we have, and this little penny anything keeps going. Miraculously, how do we even pay for what we've got, much less everything else? You know? The answer is, it's not the people, it's not the money, it's the beginning that we have. It's a foundation, spiritual, it's God's, it's not even ours. That's why it's not a comparison of It's just a reality of the temporal dealing compared to an eternal dealing. And we've chosen to embrace with all of our heart. You know what I mean? There's a, you know, I will not let go of this. And I will not let go of Christ and Him crucified in the center, because it was before us and it's going to be long after us. When we're all sitting in heaven, it's all over. There's going to be a lamb as though it had been slain on the throne. Christ and Him crucified. And we're going to go, this has been our life and this will be our life throughout all eternity. You know? So, you know, there's a foundation. Then we can do any number of ministries, and we'll do many ministries and different things along the way. You know what I mean? And ministries will come and go, and emphasis at the temporal dealing times will come and go. But we better never get off of the word and Christ being crucified. Get off of that? It's like a vapor. It appears for a while, and then it vanishes. Right?
Okay. Yeah, along the same lines, I've been thinking about all of this thing that I've been hearing from different places about the revival. And according to that, God could be sending revival in different places and for different churches. But if they're not founded on the Word, then when the revival, which will eventually not fade but pass, go on to other things, sure. then if they're not founded on the Word, then there's going to be people wondering whether that truly was a revival of God, and start blaming things on God or doing something along those lines.
Which I believe it will. It'll actually be a part of a precipitating thing that turns people against the Lord eventually. But here's what I believe, and this is what I believe. I'm saying, here's what I believe. I'm not saying this is all God or what you should believe. I'm just saying here's what I believe. I believe that that right now we're in a time of dryness. Kind of a time of dryness, okay? I believe that there's going to come a time of revival. I'll draw that by having the line that goes up. The straight line is the dryness, the upgoing line is the time of revival. Okay, so it goes up, and the emphasis is there's going to be, and it'll truly be a Holy Spirit revival. Okay, there's going to be two different kinds of things taking place at that, or not just two, though we admitted, but I'm going to emphasize two right now. One is there's going to be a church who is established on the Word. And so when revival comes, they will establish their people on the Word.
Along with in the revival.
In the revival. There is those who were established on the Word before the revival. When it was dry. Jesus said, if you see these things in a dry time, what about in a green tree? Well, that's true in a negative and a positive sense. If you can... You know, if you can be stable and excited when nothing's going on and live for God, and you know what I mean, and have life when nothing's going on, then revival's a piece of cake. You don't have to go, oh, I'm in revival. You're going to a little revival. It's pretty much going to be for everybody else. All it means to me is I'm going to have my hands full.
Yeah.
Revival doesn't really change anything. As far as
not really, unless, and here's now this gets to my point, unless if you're established on that and revival comes, then there may be a lot of people up here in revival that you can draw into the Word. That you can say, okay, and that may not happen in the upgoing, but more in the downswing and in the end. In the downswing of revival, that's when it begins to slightly fade. People aren't as excited. There's not, you know, it's like trying to witness to somebody in Six Flags. You know what I mean? Look, I'm just out here fine, okay? You know what I mean? You need Jesus. Yeah, right. You know, now I need to get on that rock or whatever. You know, and that's kind of the way they're at there. But when they begin to realize, you know, this isn't as exciting as not, you know, I mean, your emotions can only take so much for one. Do you know that? I mean, in anything, you can only be so down or so up for a period of time, and then something's going to give. And I know this would be. So once it starts down, that's when you if you're there and you say, look, let's get over here, and you start getting him in the Word and stuff like that, then the revival has actually done its part. It has brought in a whole lot of people. And you can draw those people into the Word, and you can get something founded that is eternal.
What is the other?
Well, the other thing that I didn't give is dry revival comes, and it will eventually swing down, and what will happen? happen is that people will say, where is the coming of the Lord? Where is, you know, and this did, you know, this was good for a while. I think the charismatic movement kind of did good. I think people are, you know, they don't want to go to church and all this kind of stuff, and therefore probably more people against God after the charismatic movement than before. That's my opinion. But, you know, the churches did what, 7 years ago? There were more people in churches during the charismatic movement than had ever been. You check it now, folks, there are almost no churches with Sunday night or Wednesday night services. All you can get is a good old-fashioned Sunday morning religious attendance.
Most people are going to great services. I mean, a lot of people that in the churches, they replace the charismatic thing to a spiritual other thing that they weren't able to find, or they didn't think they were able to get in the charismatic. Now they're switching over to the wage thing.
Right, right. Or, you know, getting into computers. Or music. Or, I mean, honestly, they're just, I mean, they were into something. And you're into it because it's emotionally rewarding. Well, when it stops being emotionally rewarding, guess what? You know, the devil sends you something.
That's right.
You'll grab that sucker. And, you know, he'll break the peace. The word miracles, Bible says.
Yeah.
The miracles we have, and they'll go, this is the one, miracle, miracle. You know what I mean? You know, instead of being able to hang on the cross and say, you know, I don't need a miracle to get down here. I'm given, my life is already taken with Jesus on the cross. That I, you know, I don't have to be blessed to serve God. Everything doesn't have to be rosy. I want to serve God because I love Him and because the truth has worked in me and His nature has worked in me. And here I go. You know, and then they said, hey, come follow us, miracles. Jesus said, when they say, oh, he's over here, go down after him. You know where he's at. The kingdom is within you. The kingdom of government is within you. Oh, it's over here. It's happening over here. I've been with it for quite a few years now. I've had that guy go, oh, it's happening over here. You know, there have been churches right here in town that started springing up, fast growth, springing up. And, you know, come over and join this church. Get involved in, you know, or come join us and everything. Look not after it. Go not after it. Kingdom is within me. And, you know, people laugh and go, well, you got this penny-ante ministry over here. And I believe that still it is yet to be seen what God's going to do with us. I believe that. I believe it is yet to be seen. But I know that right now we are a support to a lot of people who you don't even know we support. Just the fact that we're here and we keep going. It's amazing. It's amazing. But it's a spiritual thing. It's not us. It's not New Creation Fellowship. It is people founded on the Word, and that Word is getting out. And, you know, I don't know if you fully realize this, but this is something we've been talking about. We're in the process. Dr. Titus said that they put him in charge of all of the Spirit-filled Bible schools in India, and that every Bible school is now going to have a library, and that he's in charge of seeing that all 50 charismatic Spirit-filled Bible schools in India, this is all Spirit-filled Bible school, all, you know, places in India, and he asked for a copy of all of my books to put in. For each library.
All of them?
Well, as many as we can get. Right now we're starting to buy basically machines, whatever. But, you know. And they're going to translate it. Okay, well, we always said, our job is to get the word. We've always said that. Al and Pat were telling me that, you know, they were the ones who helped wake me up. They said, next year is the Olympics in Atlanta. The 4 years after that's the next Olympics, and it won't be in the United States. 4 years after that's the next one, it won't be in the United States. This is 96, 4 years away from the year 2000. And they said, it will be one of the biggest convergence of Christians from all over the world to come minister there. And that's where we need to go in with our literature to Christians and get it in there, just pass it out free, and they'll take it back all over the world. And we've always said, God is going to make us important to get the word out. And I'm sitting there going, well, maybe we go there and witness it to some athletes. You know? They're going, wake up, Randy. This is it. This is the big one. You know, this is the biggie. We can hit thousands of Christian organizations with the word of God and Christ and Him crucified and the emphasis of God's kingdom. So right now we're in the process of praying and believing God to bring in the finances to be able to get all this stuff printed up. What an opportunity. Wow. What an opportunity. And I believe that to be able to do this and both of those and more that God will send is the fulfillment of what He brings in the creation. To be able to get the word out in the hands, not that, you know, if we end up training people, but I don't think that we're going to be some sort of big, huge organization in the end. I think we're going to be still a small cog as large as it is. But I think that there are going to be people who are fed up with revival and miracles and everything else in that form, and they're going to want just flat Jesus. Give me life. I want Jesus. And then they're going to read some of our literature, and it will open their eyes or begin to point them in the direction of the Word, and they'll begin to see that. And there will be many people, and of course they may be raised up way bigger than us and end up spreading the Word way more than we can.
That's still us.
But that's still us. And what's important is somebody put it in us long before we came along.
Yeah.
You know, we're just part of a long line of what God's doing. You know what I mean? We're just a small little cog in this thing, but I want to be the cog God's made us to be. And it's exciting to me to realize that because it's been a long time coming, and the time thing is converging with the spiritual thing. And then another sign that I see is that, and this is just a general principle, if you ever notice it, frustration always sets in greater just before the thing happens. That's true across the board. Across the board. If you're working on a full-time job and you're supposed to go into the ministry, you know God told you you will. Just months before God releases you, you're going to sense in your spirit a real, there's going to be an increase of a desire to ministry. Right? Okay, and so there's this increase, you go, I want to minister, but you don't see the time frame and realize you're fixing to be released. So you're really frustrated. Oh, man, come on, God. And of course, that's the time to not jump. You've got to be really careful. Dangerous. Okay. Well, I see a frustration in me going, come on, you know, I can't tolerate little things. You know, and I've tolerated, huge things. And it's like, oh, come on, we gotta get this now. You know, but I feel we're getting real close. And it's like, you know, we don't need to be fooling around right now, it's almost here, you know. But it's all about to happen. I believe this. I believe the next 5, 6, 7 years, I believe that we will see God move with us more than He ever has in the purpose that He calls. But, you know, by then, He will have weeded out all the people that stood around after a while. They go, there ain't nothing happening here. You know, man, I've been here 2 years, nothing happened. We're all just sitting around feeding ourselves. Maybe it's something, but that ain't what God did. Big revival. I'm going to go over there where God's moving. They'll go over there where God's moving. You know, and God will dangle and the devil will dangle and everything. And, you know, all of our motives will be brought to light. We'll run after this. We'll chase after that. We'll want this and that. And there'll be a small group. Go, look, Lord knows it's been dry. Lord knows it's been dry. But this is where God's got me. This is the reason why I'm here, and I'm going to be faithful to that. God will bring it to pass. just one final thing along that to help you to really realize it. But and I'm not going to preach this, but I just want to kind of introduce it, is the seven feasts of Israel. The seven feasts of Israel show this. Also, the harvest season. The harvest season, which goes along with the seven feasts of Israel, the harvest season in Israel is like that. There is the early and the latter rain, okay? And the early rain comes and it softens the ground and it gets real wet and everything and makes it just right so that the harvest that was planted over here when it was dry, but, you know, for a season, the harvest starts coming up. And there's this initial first fruits with the early rain. There's an initial first fruit that begins to spring out, okay? But then they go through this dry season, and it's a long dry season, and the initial thing was real exciting and everything, and then it begins to kind of wane and, you know, get down, and then they have rains, and every once in a while there's a little bit of a something, but it's not really the scheduled earlier latter rain. This is an official thing. I mean, it's just like it happens every year, okay? And so then it gets, and the closer it gets to the latter rain, it gets, the harvest gets really dry, like it's all going to be burned up. And it looks like it's all dying. And all of a sudden the latter rain falls and the harvest just all comes up and it's just the last of the harvest season. And all, he reaps in all of this and that's the end. Well, I think we're experiencing this last dry thing. You know, oh, we're all going to die, nothing's going on, this is stupid, I could have been an account. Look out, boy, I'm alive. You know.
Yeah, with that former latter rain, the majority of the nutrients that the plants get is right before the latter rain,
right,
in the driest time.
Right.
That's when they get all the really good stuff, that's when they get fed the real...
Right.
That,
and that's why when the rain hits, they take off.
Yeah.
But just before that rain hits, you know, you don't really realize, you know, that you're taking in nutrients and this is the most important time. You know, well, gee, there seems to be a change in the word. There seems to be I feel it, but I don't see any results. Well, that's when the rain hits you. And so, back to, because I think you had your hand up, I made the statement that just before that happens, just before, and this is just a universal principle, frustration sets in. Okay. You raise your hand.
Yeah, because usually my students on a full-time job, and that's called an issue. They see that frustration, they don't know. It's like almost like the end of curing a child, or the end of,
yes,
towards the letter, this is discomfort. It's just like, I have to say this, you know.
Right.
And that can tell me they see promotion for the extra money.
Right.
Or they buy a new house, also they're tied out of the world.
Right.
When they just wait on the Lord, you know, because they're frustrated, they feel like they need to relieve that pressure. And if you're used to relieving,
right,
the pressure that way by,
sure,
gratification, then you'll do that and you'll miss it. Because I know that I've been something I've been struggling with is sensing some sort of frustration over a certain circumstance. And go, well, why did I just move it? I thought, what if I move it? I get tied somewhere.
Right.
So what if I move it? I miss the Lord because I get off somewhere. You know, it's like, you know, but we don't realize that we're so busy with our we get so busy with our frustration, but if you understand that principle where, you know, that dryness or frustration, the heaviness or whatever that comes is actually not the time to move, you know, not the time to seek your way out of the situation, you know. So.
Well, we just had a situation yesterday where we had a gathering over a certain person who there were many testimonies how God had really used them the last couple of months in particular. And they made that statement to a person. Well, I wish God could have used, I wanted God to use me, and I wish he could have used me in another way. But if this is how he's going to use me, then so be it. Well, I believe that that person was meant, or initially, plan A was meant to be another way. It was coming by way. I believe they were seated in a chair at one time right here with this group. They're called to be seated in the chair right here with this group. They're called to be taught and trained. But seated next to them was a guy that appealed to them, and they started thinking about houses. You know, boy, if I could have a house, kids. You know, of course they don't have houses, but, you know, if I could have a house and kids and all these things, this would be life. their wants and their desires for certain things first. And when they did, they jumped the gun and grabbed something that wasn't initially the Lord. Can God use anything?
Yes.
Did God use this?
Yes.
Is God still glorified?
Yes.
Is this person with the Lord?
Yes.
Is this, I mean, if plan A is ruined and go with plan B, God will still make something out of plan B. But I would personally rather be with plan A. God has a good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. Give me the perfect will, as much as I can. You know, one way you get out of that is that you begin to get frustrated. You jump the gun. You say, okay, you know, well, it's frustrating. Nothing's going on around here. And this church over here offered me this big position as praise and worship leader, and they're going to pay me a salary, and man, it's happening over there, and I mean, you know, all people here are just going to go, you know what I mean? But if God said be here, you know what I'm saying? Then you end up missing it all.
But you're not saying that that person came down with a bad circumstance or a problem because they didn't go with plan A.
No, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying, to me, that, you know, my opinion, you may not like my opinion, but my opinion is the thing that they ended up with is better than a long line under the circumstances that they had come out.
Because at least the Lord came out.
The Lord did. The Lord did touch this family. The father told him yesterday, he believes in God now, he didn't believe in God. Church on Sunday.
But plan A would have been better. But
well, now this is, I'm really saying what I believe is my opinion. I mean, I'm not God. I don't know. But I believe that there was a plan A. This is my opinion. But I believe there's a plan A. I believe that the devil dangled something and they grabbed it. And I don't believe everybody in this room has to agree with me. But that's my opinion. And I see the devil do that with people all the time. I see stuff that other people go, and they have their agenda in them. And when the enemy dangles something in that direction, they're willing to grab that. But our life is Christ. And that can't happen unless God is already dealing with it. You know? In other words, if nobody, not the Lord, not leadership, not friends, ever sat down with the person we're talking about and said, not the Lord. Don't do it. Seek first the kingdom. And they jumped off the bandwagon and said, no, this is what I want.
So, I just know I used to have a problem and still do. Is, you know, when my friend Ernest got killed, you know, I had a lot of people say, well, he shouldn't move to Ohio, blah, blah, blah. He died because he got out of the road. And I had a problem with that. So, you know, for a couple of years, you know, I had to go through this thing.
Right.
Every time, what if I made a wrong decision? Something terrible thing happened to me, or blah, blah, blah.
Right.
You know, when you get this fear thing, and when you hear something like that, you could think if you already have, you know, you're struggling with it, you might think, oh, because she missed God's will this happened.
Well, I think she died because of God.
Yeah.
Now, that's my opinion. Not because she missed God. I think the dying part is probably God's will. I know that sounds weird, but it was God's will for Samson. It was God's will for Jesus. It was God's will for, I mean, we can just go, you know, Paul said this to you know, I've drawn 22 to stay here or to die and go be with the Lord. He said to die do far better. I mean, I think that's a deal. You know, so I don't think Ernest or her died because they were out of God's will. But I think she particularly, the Lord ordered this, and I think it was in a way the cup that God offered her. And I think she drank God's cup, and I think she was right on the will of God. I really know. I mean, I really believe that she's more right on it than, and who knows? See, I might even be able to say more right on than she would have been with what I call plan A. Because I don't know. But I just know that initially, I know that there was a point where something was dangled in front of her and she read it because she had it once and she wanted it. But that's not grounds for
well, see,
I'm not saying stupid, but I used to think that it's good, and sometimes I would have struggled.
Oh, no, no, no.
Lord doesn't, you know, just zap you because you screw up with it. I mean, I, he's not, I know that it's immature, but, I mean, I've been getting more mind than him, but sometimes.
Well, like Jerry said, I think this is the answer. Jerry said the wages of sin is death, and that's why Jesus died. If you're a Christian and you've sinned, well, Jesus died, there's the death. We don't have that.
No, it wasn't. I wasn't saying that as a point of her sinning so death. I wasn't equating it to her that way. In case anybody's thinking that, that was not my equation that she said. That wasn't the point.
I think the caution I feel in the Lord is one of those weird sort of misunderstandings in communication thing that can happen, like out there underneath the tree. When we were saying one thing and everybody raised their hand and go, yeah, that's what I was thinking. And it was totally weird and different. And that is, if we're not really careful with the whole concept of plan A and plan B, for those of us who are still alive and feel like at some point in our lives we went with plan B, can you imagine how much regret and torment that you can never, ever fix or do anything about if we do not very carefully explore the whole comment and the concept of plan A and B. And then, even if you feel like you never have missed it, the fear of missing it, if you feel like there's a way to choose a plan B that is irreversible and your life will never, ever be quite what it could have been. And I know you're not saying that.
Right.
And I know that's not the spirit of what you're saying. But in the same way that was weird out there, I sort of feel here like, oh boy, there's a real potential here, and there could be thoughts, and I would probably be surprised if people aren't thinking that right now, if I think the Lord tell me that people are thinking like that.
Well, that's why Cindy brought it up. We're not.
And it's not so much the death thing.
No, that really is.
Can there be anything in God that's irrevocable? And that's nothing but then torment.
Yes.
Because God can restore what the cankerworm has eaten up. And like I said one time, you can choose plan B.
Right.
And if there's true repentance
and a
new beginning, then it becomes plan A.
Right.
And you don't have to have
that's
regret
exactly
the rest of your life.
Because you can say, this is plan A, and then here's plan B, and plan A would have kept going. So we end up, we get off on plan B, and something in our mind says, okay, well, then that's it. Okay, but that's not it with God. Let's say that you really did get off or whatever. But let me tell you, God never gives up. In fact, he never gives up. I mean, the thing that I have found about him, he never gives up. And he does everything he can and will. And in many cases, I have seen this, many cases where people got off on plan B and ended up back on plan A. And you can say ended up back on it, or somehow because they made the adjustments is really the way I would say it. I mean, I'm not even talking about, guys, it's so hard to put this in words that you can't take wrong. But God still ended up getting what he wanted out of the situation. And I think what God wanted out of the person that we were talking about is Christ. And I think what he got was a lot of Jesus.
Amen. On
the basis of Christ and him crucified. And so that's why I say that basically, as far as the end result of their life, it was what God wanted.
Amen.
From over here before they got off. The problem is, it took this to wake them up to how much they needed this. But now, we're drawing all this linear stuff here.
Yeah.
But in reality, we're right back to what we were talking about earlier. That we're not talking about, how do I put it, somebody else?
Well, it's like in the beginning was the word, and then at the end is the word. When the word was written, it passed away. And linear situations, like a particular call and plan in your life, is part of heaven and earth.
Well, this is what we're talking about, getting the concept of getting off or getting on.
It's a
wrong
statement. It's like it's a thing happening in heaven and earth, but God's goal is the word in the beginning and at the end is the word, and the word is Christ. And so if God uses something called plan B to bring forth all the word together,
right,
Christ, then linearly you might see a lot of lines, but if he gives his son, who's really plan A, you know, he may have wanted a different role, but that's all
she resigned herself to God's will and purpose for whatever was needed to accomplish his goal, and she took him accepted into the Spirit. And I remember telling Kelly that, you know, I believe God wants me to come to this school. I could go back home, go back on the streets like I usually do, you know, ministry and get shot by accident. I mean, that's a chance that happens back where I live. It's happened before. And everybody's mentality is, we don't understand what happened. You know, the Lord talked to him, you know, the Lord told me to go to Bible school, what's wrong with God? Or, you know, who made the wrong decision? Or did I, you know, if that had happened, did I do something wrong for us? We gotta realize, you know, come to, we have to present ourselves to God's will and purpose, not what we see. You know, like I said, when I was here, at that time, I really showed God wanted to want to be here at this school. But what if God decided for some particular reason, it was a greater purpose for Christ to come off by me getting shot? There was nothing I would lose because my life was really lost.
Of course, the last couple of semesters, Eternal Plan of God, Plan B was the cross. But look at what happened to Plan B. And there is no loss with God. Jesus said, with all that my Father has given me, I have lost none. I think, there's things that we do that, I remember one thing that Don Bird said, that you might be choose the wrong door, choose doors 1, 2, and 3, that God is always greater than your choice, Jesus is still Jesus.
I think part of it is the distinction between the eternal plan of God and God's plan of your life and your ministry. And he might not have been as effective with you doing it in terms of ministry, but ended up with the nature of Christ and ministering like that, that's what it's all about. And you'll go into eternity with satisfaction.
I was going to say, because ultimately, what we're talking about here is a linear circumstantial thing when we make choices. And ultimately, God wants us to be established in that which is eternal, anyway, the spirit of reality. So,
no matter how many mistakes.
If you go to plan A to plan B to plan C to plan Z, if you end up conforming to the image of Christ, then really, ultimately, God's purpose for life hasn't been fulfilled. But, also, I know that, for me, when I heard you share this could be my own negative jump that I have, recently begun to come out of, is that when you hear this, it starts to put fear in you. Well, I don't want to mess up that. I want to stay right on track, and you're going to do that. But I noticed that God, for a couple of reasons, I think he allowed the first one to allow free will, because it was always, well, it's plan B. You're implying that free will is that, all in a sense.
Right.
And then the other thing is, God has used those times where I have taken a big detour, just like gotten way off, maybe never get back right where it needs to be, to show me his grace and my lack of ability to trust myself. Because I always trust my name, I always do the right thing, but how would I ever have learned God's grace? That's not justification. Like, well, that's going to go off and do my best to show me his grace, and that's not going to cross. You know, that's a total, in the face of Romans 6, but that's the times that he has shown, that's where he showed Abraham, that's where he showed David a lot of things, and for me, I can't say, maybe God's going to show me those things if I stepped on plan A, I don't know that, he never will, but I know those times have been one of the most precious times when I've realized that I have been off, and I have had to learn to live with the Lord in a whole new way, and he has shown me himself, and I become more established, so I can stay on plan A the next time, really, so I see how he uses those things, and they are all linear, though, they have to be put in their place, for me,
Well, I believe no matter how many times we get off, there's always the potential of going back to what God originally intended. I just really believe that, in most cases, there's always that potential. It just really does get down into, what is the real issue? The real issue is the eternal plan of God, Christ being crucified. And that is ultimately what you conform to, what you want, what you have fulfilled. Your purpose for existence. And if you, read 2 people to the Lord or 50 to the Lord, depending on the choices that you made, that relates more to the Lord's that right? Sadness would be, you know, I love you, but you can get over sadness in the sense of, you know, but fear can control. And so I really appreciate somebody bringing this up. Now I'm bringing it up, and I know it's probably not safe. So I don't know how to say it's going to be another hour of what. But
it was pretty clear. I mean, I thought, see, I've been battling because I knew it wasn't the Lord to have that kind of fear.
Right.
So I knew it had to become the devil and not clear understanding.
Right.
So little by little, I need to become free from this torment. But because this torment. You want to be right, but you're screwed up. But you're trying to get things back on that. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And you have all this stuff. You've heard about different people and all this, and you try to, you know, and then that's just where you go, man, I trust the Lord that He's my righteousness, and this by faith and my heart is toward Him. Then, you know, like you were explaining, it made sense, you know, after everyone started talking and you explained that, to me it was very clear exactly what you're talking about. And I figured you were saying something different. That's why I said, not saying this, right? So I can confirm to myself, you know, that this is the truth.
I really appreciate you bringing that, because I'm not always aware. However, I knew I was stepping on the eggshell when I brought this particular situation up. But I weighed before the Lord, should I? I felt like the Lord said yes. So maybe it was because you or others here were dealing with the situation with that, and it needed to be brought out. But I, you know, I normally won't bring up situations like that because that's real fertile ground for the work. It's real good. So I probably went off on Plan B when I did it.
Which one was it? Plan B.
I think, you know, from what the Lord showed me, we need to think more in terms of the good, perfect, and acceptable will of God is before us every moment of every day.
Right.
It's not so much in terms of this huge deal, but in every interaction we have and in every choice we make, because this is a walk, man. This is a life. This is a thing, and it has peaks and valleys and over and that. But the real reality is all that is made up of a bunch of decisions. What is good, perfect, acceptable, and that's before us every day. And because that is worrying about today and the now and everything while it's today, and our emphasis and focus was today, I want it to be real, I want it to be Christ, I want it to, you know, and that's probably more of an accurate way of sort of viewing the thing, because then you choose acceptable yesterday. When you got to get a new beginning, that cannot linger in the shadows for always. So then you choose good today, and you can't be so concerned about, well, golly, what's that going to, because you're right, eternally, in terms of, because it's about a state of being. God wants us, you know, with the Son and not what we do and all this stuff. And eventually, you know, we can get to that. And God can worry about the particulars. You know, it's just like today, while it's today, and good, perfect, acceptable in this transaction, after we get up from this class, and as we walk to dinner today.
Well, let me just say, well, how does all this fit into what we're teaching? Well, this is exactly what we're teaching.
Yes.
If you get founded on the Word right now, first, as much as you can, then your decision for good, acceptable, and perfect will have more input, more notes, more from the Lord to be able to stay on. You understand what I'm saying? And so the Word is bringing them in now, in the beginning of the Word, and that'll dictate your walk. If you let it in, you'll have every reason to believe it will, because you're giving yourself to that. You're putting it first. And if you get in the habit of putting it first, you know, habits are hard to break, but they're also easy to go with. And if it's a good habit, that's even better. It makes it easier on you. And so that's why I say make it a habit. You know, I had brothers, you know, in the Bible school, they're, oh man, you know, we're having this early morning prayer thing. And, you know, I had a hard time just hearing what they're saying. Early morning, a hard time in the morning. So, just sitting there. But I could wake right up and start reading the Word. And I felt like, you know, in the beginning should be the Word. The Word. You know, making that real in my daily life, making my choices based on.
Just one thing I was thinking too about the Lord is that, you know, one thing that you get a sense of unrest or a real, like, sleep saying,
back on if you're off, is to just go to the Word, because the Word is what's going to be there at the end. The Word is what God's plan is about, and you can find rest if you're lined up with the Word. You can know you're right with God at that time. If you get with the Word, you can have rest. And the opposite of torment is rest. And rest comes from entering in, and entering in comes from you receive God's Word. I just thought the Lord just kind of showed me that, that you find your rest with the Word because you can't.
See how powerful the Word is, your Son, what that means. And we haven't just received the book, but we've received your Son. And the reality, the relationship that we have through, Father, we just ask you.